Hello everyone, my name is Pekka Kyösti. I work as a research director in Oulu University 6G Flagship Programme. My responsibility there is radio propagation modeling and characterization. And today I will be talking about radio propagation and channel modeling for 6G. And this is the content of my talk. So first some introduction, then three topics. First is integrated sensing and communications. What does it mean for channel modeling? Then FR3, frequency range 3. Something about the identified needs and the work towards defining a channel model for that frequency range. And then sub-terahertz frequency range between 100 and 300 gigahertz that we have been working here at Oulu University already for several years. But first, some introduction. So what is this all about? What is radio channel characterization? So it is a combination of physics, mathematics, and engineering. And it's physics because it's really studying of the physical reality, the laws of physics, how electromagnetic waves propagate and interact with the physical environment. Then mathematics, because we are developing models, and models are always mathematical structures that somehow simplify the reality and the laws of physics. And then also engineering for two reasons. First of all, the need for channel models is always defined by some engineering problems. Do we want to evaluate and test this or that algorithm, etc.? And also measurements that are important part of those, they are done based on good engineering practices. And how to do channel characterization? Well, the right-hand figure shows the diagram of that. Channel sounding first, measurements, then parameter estimation, getting parameters by using signal processing algorithms, then this channel characterization, getting many different views to the channel by analyzing data, analyzing estimated parameters, and then finally drawing implications to system design, algorithm design, antenna design, and also for developing channel models that can be used for simulating and performance evaluating of different system components. And yeah, what is new in 6G channel modeling, then, to summarize it here, well, new frequency ranges, FR3, which is very interesting for industry, and work is started in 3GPP, then sub-terahertz, that is not so hot topic for the industry at the moment, but in academia, we are very interested in that, and many universities, research institutes are working on that. Then new is also some applications, like integrated sensing and communications. It brings new challenges for channel modeling. Reconfigurable intelligent surfaces is another thing. Extreme MIMO, and of course many other aspects. So let's start with ISAC, integrated sensing and communications. What does it mean? Basically, it means using same devices and maybe even same signals for both communication purposes and for sensing purposes. And on top right, you can see a figure about monostatic sensing case, where the base station on the left-hand side box is communicating with the UE on the right-hand side with those green arrows, but also it's trying to detect, sense those objects nearby it. And of course, this kind of ISAC concept can be implemented by adding sensing type of functions and processing on top of those communication networks and devices. And detection and tracking of objects, their orientation and trajectory, etc. It's maybe the first use case for ISAC. And it can be monostatic, bistatic, multistatic. But then later on, there are many, many use cases that are under discussion. For example, mapping of environments or sensing human body activities, for example, heart beating, breathing, eye blinking, and many, many other aspects and activities of humans can be possibly sensed. So first, about this detection of location and maybe speed, etc. So what does it mean in channel modeling perspective? So if we want to detect objects in some environment in certain locations, then of course the model cannot be completely random. So we cannot draw randomly just some MIMO channel matrices. We cannot even draw randomly some angles and propagation delays and attenuations and then compose a model, because those objects must have a location and the environment must be defined to some extent. So the models must be spatially consistent, and depending on the used case also include something about the environment itself. Backscattering via this radar cross-section modeling, it will be important. It doesn't exist in the current models, and we can conduct new measurements and also utilize existing literature for that. And current geometry-based stochastic models, they need several upgrades, as mentioned, backscattering, moving objects, specular reflections, and other things must be included. The other option, of course, or maybe they will go in parallel, is to use more deterministic type of channel modeling for ISAC. And there we can start by taking, for example, the map-based model or ray tracing model as a starting point. And some of those are already defined in 3GPP 38.901 specification. And then later in time, if we go to other use cases that are not only like detecting objects and their locations, etc., then those channel modeling needs must be identified case by case. For example, this heartbeat detection, how to model it in a channel model. It's something quite specific, and not all channel models, they don't need to cover that kind of function. 3GPP just recently, in December last year, initiated a new study item to study ISAC and ISAC channel modeling, and there will be identified use cases and scenarios, frequency ranges, sensing modes, and so on and so forth. And the 3GPP current 38.901 model will be taken as the starting point. And what kind of activities or research it will require? So first, identify and define missing channel model components as compared to the existing legacy models, and then perform some measurements to determine, for example, parametrization of radar cross-section of different objects, and probably many other things as well. Just an example, like very preliminary channel model. It has been implemented in Keysight technologies, and here are some figures of those. So top left, we see the sensing device, which is the circle and the cross, so transmitter and receiver in the same location, monostatic sensing. Then there are static clusters, if you like, those gray rectangles. And then three moving objects with those colored lines showing the trajectory of objects over time. And then the sensing device is base station, so there are in total 16 elements receiving, one element transmitting. And on the right-hand side, top figure, we can see how does the range versus time look like. Of course, those static clutter, they don't move. The range doesn't change, but then those moving objects, we can see some time variability over there. And then bottom right is what the base station receiver would see after beamforming, performing this kind of Bartlett beamforming, observing the power angular distribution in azimuth domain versus times. And there we can, if we compare those bottom right and top left, we can identify those locations of the moving objects. Okay, then we move to the second topic, channel modeling for FR3. And as said, this is very hot topic in industry. And these frequencies between 7 and 24 gigahertz, they are seen very promising in 3GPP release 19. So what does it mean for channel modeling? In principle, 3GPP model covers all frequencies between 0.5 and 100 gigahertz. So case closed. Well, not exactly. So those existing 3GPP modules were originally developed for lower frequencies, and there are some defects that now can be improved. And there are, of course, some differences when comparing FR3 and FR1, especially. So extremely large antenna arrays, they provide very high angular resolution, meaning very precise beamforming. And also there's a chance that in some cases the far field distance is violated, or we might be in the near field of an antenna array. And another thing is that at FR3 there are more bandwidth available, so potentially the bandwidth will be much larger, meaning we have higher delay resolution and beamforming might become sensitive to bandwidth effects, for example, beam squinting. And here in the slide, there is too much text, but just 3 points, or maybe 4. Truly dynamic channel modules are needed for FR3 evaluations. That's one thing. Then another thing is that amplitude fading in existing 3GPP channel modules, it's always Rayleigh for non-line of sight parts, but this might not be realistic at FR3 and not at FR2 either. And the third thing is that those clusters, that there's a specific structure in the model for cluster. Each cluster is composed of 20 subparts having equal gains and different angles. So that structure needs to be revisited. And maybe the last one is that in some cases, really, then we might need near-field modeling as well in the form of spherical wavefronts. Some figures about those points. So first of all, these truly dynamic channel models. So this is an example from CTIA, MIMO OTA test plan. We can do it by defining waypoints, a route for an UE, for example, defining propagation parameters, coordinates, speed, orientation, etc. at each waypoint, and then interpolating linearly all parameters in between waypoints. And then we get a smoothly evolving dynamic channel, as you can see from those figures. For example, top right figure showing time axis on the horizontal and vertical is the channel gain. And we can see different distance-dependent part losses in line of sight, non-line of sight condition, different fading dynamics depending whether it's line of sight or non-line of sight, and so on. Then this might be a little bit too detailed, but let's take it briefly. So those 20 equal gain rays, as I said, it will always give Rayleigh type of fading as shown in the middle figure there. So close to 40 dB dynamic variation of the channel gain over time. And this might be not realistic at FR3 or FR2. If there's specular reflections, then there will be one dominant path and maybe some weaker scattering parts. So we need to study this by measurements and maybe change the mathematical structure to enable one dominant subparts and several non-equal gain scattered subparts. Another thing about this cluster structure is here. So on the right-hand side, we can see 20 red dots. So they are those 20 subparts of a single cluster, all equal gain. Then we have an example antenna array, the middle figure there, with 47 rows. It's a planar array, 27 columns. And then it has quite narrow half power bandwidth, as we can see on the right-hand side figure, this yellow beam. And we can clearly see that this beam is able to resolve, to pick out several of those subparts. And this means that the channel model, the structure of it will be like over-optimistic in a sense. So it will provide too rich scattering in environment. And as ISAC also, this one is in 3GPP. There's a new study item established and the work will start towards a channel model for FR3. Then the last is this sub-terahertz. So as I said in the beginning, we have been working with this for several years already. And what have we been doing is to develop channel sounder for it. we have performed different kind of blockage measurements to get the characteristics of blocking events, for example, a human finger or human body. I have a figure of it later on. We have developed in the European HEXAX project a stored channel model. We have conducted some directional channel measurements, and we will be doing more channel modeling also for ETSI pre-standardization, near-field, far-field channel modeling, and we extract many different implications for the system designs. Just a quick look at the channel sounder here, correlation-based channel sounder having, well, transmitter for PN sequences, receiver mechanically rotating directive antenna units, and it can speed up the measurement as compared to VNA-based system. Examples from measurements, so the finger measurement on left and human body on right, so really how much attenuation a finger or body can cause, and it can be 30-40 dB even at these frequencies, 140 and 300. Stored channel model, so there is even data and code available in Senodo from HEXAX project, so propagation parts from measurements assisted with ray tracing, then antenna modeling and this kind of support for virtual motion to enable some Doppler and fading, etc. So that's one achievement. Then those insights in channel perspective design. So we have, for example, studied how long link distances can be achieved, what are the path losses. Are there more than the line of sight path? Yes, they are. Is it feasible to make beams to other directions also in addition to the line of sight path? Yes, it is. How many beams we have studied? We have published results. It seems that even sub-terahertz channel can support spatial multiplexing if needed, if someone wants to do it, and so on and so forth. Then this is a dream that we would like to achieve, this kind of system model covering everything from the transmitted signal to the received signal, I mean, including digital beamforming, RF non-idealities, analog beamforming, antennas, propagation channel. We are working. Yes. And time for the summary. So just what have we discussed? ISAC first. It's a somewhat new hot topic in channel modeling, and we need to develop channel measurement capability and conduct measurements and start working on developing channel model components. FR3, basically same list of actions. So the work is ongoing and starting. And then sub-terahertz, as mentioned, we have been doing it for many years, but there are still many things to do, so we are far from the full understanding of sub-terahertz channel. And we do this research in many research projects under 6G flagship program. And all results are contributed to academic publications and deliverables, but also something to ETSI pre-standardization. Thanks for listening and watching. And if you have any questions or you would like to continue discussion, I'm happy to do it afterwards.